Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 10th of May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles taken up for today's analysis and the page numbers of Chennai, Bengaluru, Delhi and Thiruvananthapuram editions. The handwritten notes in PDF format and the timestamping of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion will be available in the description section below and also in the comment section. Let us now move on to the discussion of the news articles taken up for today's analysis. The first article of the day is the editorial title Loud and Clear. The trade tensions between USA and India and some suggestions to address these trade tensions have been discussed in this editorial. This editorial appears in page number 8 in all the four editions. The analysis of this article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national and international importance and will be also relevant in your mains preparation in your general studies paper 2 under bilateral agreements involving India and affecting India's interests, next under effects of policies and politics of developed countries on India's interests. Let us now move on to the discussion of this editorial. Recently, TradeWinds Indo-Pacific Forum concluded in New Delhi. In this forum, the US Secretary of Commerce visited India along with a 100-member business delegation. In this meeting, the US Secretary of Commerce spoke about his concerns regarding India's unfair trade practices and the barriers that are created by India, which is restricting the US companies to access the Indian markets. We have rearranged the contents given in this editorial into four subheads. Number one, the measures of USA that has affected Indian trade. Next, the measures of India that has affected USA's trade. And then regarding the current position of USA and India. First, let us see about the USA measures that has affected the Indian trade. In March 2018, USA increased the tariffs on the imports of steel and aluminium. India was affected by this decision of USA and USA has continuously refused to revoke or waive the tariff hike which was proposed by India. Next is regarding the significant reduction exemptions that USA gave to certain countries which regards to the import of oil from Iran. It is basically a waiver given to few countries including India post the USA sanctions on Iran. Under this waiver, the countries have to reduce their oil imports from Iran to zero or else they might face consequences. If you see, Iran is one of the leading suppliers of crude oil to India. This significant reduction exemptions ended on 2nd of May, which is a few days back. Next is the decision of USA to withdraw the GSP status given to India. If you see, GSP is the acronym for the Generalized System of Preferences. Under this program, around 3,500 Indian products are given duty-free access to US markets. This largely benefited countries like India. Now, USA is still considering withdrawing the GSP status given to India. If this particular GSP status is withdrawn, it will lead to imposition of tariffs and tariff increase on Indian exports. This will finally affect the India's trade and economy as well. These are some of the measures of USA that has affected India's trade with USA. Now, secondly, we are going to see some of the Indian protective measures that have affected USA's trade with India. USA is continuously voicing its concern to reduce the higher duties imposed on USA's products or its exports, such as motorcycles and American wine, for example. If you see, the import tariffs for motorcycles are around 50-60% and for American liquor it is 150%. Next, India is strict with its data localization requirements. It has asked the social media giants to save the digital data within India and not outside India. The new e-commerce regulations of India focusing on data localization, improved privacy safeguards and measures to combat the sale of counterfeit products are also making the American companies difficult to continue their trade with India. Also, India has banned the US origin dairy products. If you see, cows in India are fed with a vegetarian diet. This vegetarian diet includes grasses, hay, etc. But The diet of USA's cows include blood meal, internal organs, and also tissues of ruminant origin. All these are non-veg diets. So, India's banned the USA's dairy products, citing cultural reservations. This particular move by India made the US dairy companies very angry. They even proposed to US government to withdraw the GSP status. That's why now US is considering or reconsidering regarding the GSP status given to India. These are some of the measures of India that has affected USA's trade with India. Now, let us see the current position of USA, which is the oldest democracy in the world, and India, which is the largest democracy in the world. First, let's see the USA's position. To address the tariffs issued by USA, India is threatening to impose counter tariffs on USA's products. The USA Secretary of Commerce has openly threatened that such a move by India will definitely lead to consequences. Also, there is no chance that USA will again extend the significant reduction exemptions, which it has given to few countries including India. Next, in this editorial, some points about what should India's position be are also mentioned. Let us see them. India is continuously pushing for a comprehensive trade package and it should continue to do so. Next, India should look for an alternative oil supplier and also an alternative financial structure in order to meet its oil needs. This editorial also suggests that India can reconsider its decision and give up some unreasonable demands. Also, the new government to be formed should work in close coordination with USA in order to sort out the ongoing trade issues. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this editorial. Now, have a look at the practice mains question we shall discuss at the end of the analysis session. Let us now move on to the next news article. The second news article of the day is about the Bharatmala Pariyojana scheme. This news article titled MORTH revoked decision, NH project back on track has appeared in page number 1 in Thiruvananthapuram edition. The discussion and topic which will be covered based on this article is relevant in your prelims preparation under economic and social development, and in your mains preparation it is relevant in your general studies paper 2 under government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and issues arising out of their design and implementation, and in your general studies paper 3 under infrastructure, roads in particular. This news article discusses about the circular issued by the National Highways Authority of India, that is NHAI, under Bharatmala Pariyojana scheme. The circular categorized the national highway corridors into high priority 1 list and high priority 2 list. This became a controversy when the state of Kerala complained that the state has been placed in high priority 2 list under the scheme, and this was stalling the 4 or 6 laning of its 1078 kilometer national and state highways. After this controversy, Union Minister for Road Transport, Highways and Shipping has announced that the circular categorizing the national highway corridors in the country into high priority 1 and 2 had been withdrawn and assured that the center had not shown any discrimination against Kerala. Now, in this context, it becomes important to know about the Bharatmala Pariyojana scheme from the examination point of view. Bharatmala Pariyojana is a stepping stone towards New India as perceived by the government. It is an umbrella program for the highway sector. It focuses on optimizing efficiency of road traffic movement across the country by bridging critical infrastructure gaps. The program has been designed to bridge the gaps in the existing highways infrastructure so as to make the movement of man and material more efficient. As India is having about 54.82 lakh kilometer road network, which is the second largest in the world in terms of length. And also know that national highways constitute about 2% of the total network, but it carries around 40% of the total road traffic of India. And under this program, special attention has been paid to fulfill the connectivity needs of backward and tribal areas, areas of economic activity, places of religious and tourist interest, border areas, coastal areas, and trade routes with neighboring countries. This scheme will give the country 50 national corridors as opposed to the 6 which the country already has at present. And with this, 70 to 80% of freight will move along the national highways as against the 40% at present. The program will help to connect 550 districts in the country through national highway linkages, as currently only around 300 districts have national highway linkages. Bharatmala will also have a positive impact on the logistic performance index of the country. Apart from this, the program will also help generate a large number of direct and indirect employment. The employment will be generated based on the construction activities, the development of highways amenities. This will lead to better road connectivity, and this in turn will lead to enhanced economic activities that will generate more employment. So if you see, both of these are interconnected. Due to the sheer magnitude and spread of the scheme, it will be divided into 7 distinct phases. As of now, only the first phase is under construction. A total of around 24,800 kilometers are being considered in phase 1 of the Bharatmala Pariyojana. In addition, phase 1 also includes 10,000 kilometers of balance roadworks under National Highway Development Program, in short NHDP. Bharatmala phase 1 is to be implemented over a 5 years period, that is from the years 2017-18 to 2021-22. The components of this phase 1 are mentioned here now. They are national corridors efficiency improvements, economic corridors development, inter-corridor and feeder roads, border and international connectivity roads, coastal and port connectivity roads, and expressways. Let us now see each one of this one by one. Bharatmala envisages improving the efficiency of the national corridor. The national corridor consists of the Golden Quadrilateral and the North-South and East-West corridor. It will be done by decongesting its choke points. You should know what a choke point is. It is basically a narrow route providing passage to or through another region. And this will be carried out through lane expansion, construction of ring roads, bypasses, or elevated corridors and logistics parks at identified points. This program has identified around 26,200 km of economic corridors or routes that have heavy freight traffic. It is planned to develop these corridors end to end in order to ensure seamless and speedy travel and uniformity in standards, and an enhanced focus on improving the northeast connectivity and also leveraging synergies with inland waterways. The Northeast Economic Corridor will be enhanced by the connectivity between the state capitals and key towns. Then, the multimodal freight movement will be enabled via 7 waterway terminals on River Brahmaputra, namely Dhubri, Silghat, Bishwanath Ghat, Nyamati, Dibrugarh, Sengajan, and Oriam Ghat. Besides this, around 8,000 km of inter-corridors and around 7,500 km of feeder corridors have also been identified under Bharatmala. Inter-corridor routes are those where stretches of roads connects more than 2 corridors, and feeder corridors are routes connecting 1 or 2 corridors. These corridors will be developed to address the infrastructure asymmetry that currently exists at many places. Once built, the national and the economic corridors along with their inter-corridor and feeder routes would be able to carry around 80% of India's total freight traffic. Bharatmala also envisages building border roads which are of strategic importance along the international boundaries, and also international connectivity roads in order to promote trade with countries such as Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, and Myanmar. And as a part of port connectivity and coastal road program, it will connect the areas that are dotted along the shorelines, and to connect the important ports, the central government has ordered the construction of 2000 km of roads. More importance will be given on the construction and development of greenfield expressway for better management of traffic and freight. And the projects under Bharatmala phase 1 are to be implemented through these institutions, namely National Highways Authority of India, NHIDCL, that is National Highways and Infrastructure Development Corporation Limited, and then Ministry of Road Transport and Highways, And finally, State Public Works Department. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. The practice prelims question will be discussed at the end of the analysis session. Let us now move on to the next news article. The third news article of the day, titled Smaller Parties Field More Women, is about how political parties have given opportunity to women to contest as a candidate in the present Lok Sabha elections based on the first five phases conducted. This news article appears on page number 10 in all the four editions. This news article will be relevant in your prelims preparation under Indian Polity and Governance and in your mains preparation in General Studies Paper 1 under Role of Women and Associated Issues and Their Remedy. This news article is based on the data collected by Association for Democratic Reforms and few data sourced from the regional parties. Before entering into the analysis, let us see in brief about Association for Democratic Reforms now. It is a non-governmental organization which was established in the year 1999 by a group of professors from the Indian Institute of Management located in Ahmedabad. The goal of this organization is to improve the governance and to strengthen the democracy. How? By continuously working for electoral and political reforms. The Supreme Court in the year 2003 gave a verdict. The verdict made mandatory the disclosure of criminal, financial and educational background for all candidates before the elections. All these details should be given by filing an affidavit with the Election Commission. Know that this verdict is a result of the public interest litigation filed by ADR or the Association for Democratic Reforms in Delhi High Court in the year 1999. Now, have a look at this image taken from the Hindu newspaper. The article states that while big political parties fared poorly in giving opportunities for women to contest in the elections, some regional and small political parties have fared better in this score. This information is based on the first five phases of Lok Sabha election only. One small regional political party in the state of Tamil Nadu by the name Nam Tamilar Katchi has given 50% allocations to women to contest in the Lok Sabha elections. This part has been mentioned as a top performer in bringing general parity in positioning women to contest in the elections. Other two top performers are All India Trinamool Congress and Biju Janata Dal. All India Trinamool Congress, which is based mainly in the state of West Bengal, gave 34.15% of the seats to be contested by women, and Biju Janata Dal, the ruling regional party in the state of Odisha, has given 33%. Big national parties, particularly BJP and Indian National Congress, have on one side promised in their manifestos to bring 33% of reservation for women in the Lok Sabha. But they have not even given enough opportunity to women to contest in these general election. Their percentage is not more than 13. Finally, the data tells that only 8.82% of the total contestants are women in a country where women are 48.46% of the total population. This particular statistics is based on the 2011 census. If you see among the total independent candidates who contested this particular general election in the first five phases, only 6.69% are women. Equal political representation for women is important as a path to achieve gender equality and inclusive development. Also, to bring in better and effective safeguards for women and children, and also to promote and protect the human rights and social justice. We also have the Sustainable Development Goal number 5, which speaks about gender equality. Under this goal, we have target 5.5, where this target is to ensure women's full and effective participation and equal opportunities for leadership at all levels of decision making in political, economic and public life. Now have a look at the practice question. It will be discussed at the end of the analysis session. Now let us move on to the next news article. The fourth news article of the day is Supreme Court pushes for full strength of 31. This news article is about collegium's opposition against government's decision to rethink on appointment of new judges. This news article appears in the front page, that is in page 1 in all your four editions. The analysis of this editorial will be relevant in your prelims preparation under current events of national importance, next under Indian polity and governance, and also in your mains preparation in general studies paper 2 under structure, organization and functioning of the executive and the judiciary, and also under appointment to various constitutional posts. Let us now move on to the analysis of the news article. The Supreme Court Collegium has recommended the names of two judges to the Supreme Court. This news also states that the Collegium has rejected the government's disapproval of the elevation of two other judges to the Supreme Court. The present strength of the judges in the Supreme Court is 27 out of the total strength of 31. In this context, let us know about the Collegium system in detail from the prelims perspective. The Collegium system was introduced by the Supreme Court itself. Collegium system is basically a selection panel which consists of a group of senior most judges of the Supreme Court. This panel will select the names of the judges to be appointed. The Chief Justice of India then forwards the recommendations to the Union Minister of Law and Justice to fill up the vacancies. After the receipt of the final recommendation from the Chief Justice of India, the Union Minister of Law and Justice will put up the recommendations to the Prime Minister. Now, the Prime Minister will advise the President in the matters of appointment. Finally, the President appoints the judges to the Supreme Court. This is how the judges are appointed. This particular collegium system was introduced as a result of three judges' cases. It is a result of the orders passed by three different judges regarding the appointment of judges. Just remember the term three judges' cases for your reference. Now, you need to know why this collegium system was introduced. We know that there are three arms of government, namely executive, legislature, and judiciary. The judicial appointments in 1990s saw an increased interference by the executives in power. The judiciary hence came up with this collegium system. Also, the collegium system was envisaged as a tool that would secure and guarantee the independence of the judiciary. We know that the constitution has established an independent and an integrated judiciary in India. So, the independence of the judiciary forms a part of the basic structure of the Constitution of India. So, the collegium system is seen as a tool to guarantee this basic structure. Now, try to know about the articles that discusses the appointment of Supreme Court judges and also the High Court judges. First, Article 124 speaks about the appointment of Supreme Court judges. The judges shall be appointed by the President after consultation with the judges of the Supreme Court, that also includes the Chief Justice of India. Also, the consultation of the judges of the High Court may also be taken if the President deems it necessary. Next, Article 217 speaks about the appointment of High Court judges. The judges shall be appointed by the President after consultation with the Chief Justice of India and the Governor of the State. And in the case of appointment of a judge other than the Chief Justice, the President shall consult the Chief Justice of the High Court as well. Now, just remember that Article 124 and Article 217 is regarding the appointment of Supreme Court and High Court judges respectively. You can use the article numbers in any of your mains answers. Also, remember that nowhere the collegium system is mentioned in the Indian Constitution, not even in any of the amendments. Remember this, it is most important. In this collegium system, the selection panel for Supreme Court judges will contain five senior most judges of the Supreme Court, that also includes a Chief Justice of India. The Chief Justice of India will consult the four senior most judges of the Supreme Court and recommend the names to the Law Ministry. Next, the selection panel for the High Court judges. The selection panel for the High Court judges will contain three senior most judges of the Supreme Court, that also includes Chief Justice of India again. The Chief Justice of India will consult the two other senior most judges of Supreme Court and recommend the names to the Law Ministry. Now, there are two major criticisms over this present collegium system. Collegium system is continuously being criticized for its transparency and accountability. The first major criticism is that the collegium system is non-transparent. A written manual regarding the functioning of the collegium system has not been created so far. Also, there are no fixed criteria for selecting the judges. Sometimes you can see that the senior most judges are not promoted, which leads to issues. Next, the records of the meetings are published selectively according to the collegium's wishes. All these factors show that the non-transparency is present in the collegium system. The second major criticism is that the collegium system is non-accountable. One can often see in the news that the collegium has reversed the decisions already taken with respect to the selection of the judges. There is no written rule or a manual to take such decisions here. Next, the higher judiciary is exempted under Right Information Act of 2005. Hence, there is no accountability. Also, there is no public scrutiny with respect to the selection of the judges. If you see in country like USA, the judges are selected through public confirmation hearings and they are accountable to the Senate, which is the legislative arm of the US government. But in India, no such system exists. So all these three factors show that there is a no accountability as far as collegium system is concerned. Now, some suggestions have been mentioned here in order to improve the transparency and accountability of the collegium system. You yourself can frame general suggestions from the criticisms that we discussed now. Let us now see some of the suggestions. First, in order to improve the transparency in the collegium system, a written manual is necessary for a proper and organized functioning of the collegium. Also, a selection criteria for the judges can be created with the help of the eminent retired judges. These selection criteria should be duly followed by the collegiums in the selection process. Also, the entire selection process and the correspondence that happens during the selection process must be made publicly available in order to improve the transparency in the collegium system. Next, in order to make the collegium system more accountable, a panel of retired judges or even the legislature can be selected to make the collegium system accountable. Also, judiciary is also a public authority. Hence, the judiciary should also be brought under the ambit of Right to Information Act of 2005. And finally, the judicial appointments by the collegium system should be brought under public scrutiny. All these factors would help improve the accountability of the collegium system. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Now, have a look at the practice prelims question. We shall discuss at the end of the analysis session. Let us now move on to the next news article. The fifth news article of the day, titled Barn Owls to Play Tom, Fight Jerry in Lakshadweep, is about using barn owls as a biocontrol measure to hunt down the rats in Lakshadweep Islands. This news article appears on page number 18 in Chennai and Delhi edition and in page number 4 in Thiruvananthapuram edition. This article will be helpful in your prelims preparation under economic geography and also under general science. It will also be helpful in your mains preparation in general studies paper 3 under major crops, issues and constraints. Let us now move on to the analysis of the news article. Lakshadweep is a group of 36 islands if you see. It is also a union territory of India. This particular island is dominated by plantation crops such as coconut and arecanut. Coconut is the only major crop here. Lakshadweep stands first in India in terms of coconut production if you see. Also, Lakshadweep coconut is branded as an organic product. And the speciality here is that the Lakshadweep coconut has the highest oil content of all the coconuts in the world, where the oil content is about 82%. Now, the issue is that the rat population is heavily damaging the tender coconuts, and this has resulted in about 30-40% of loss in the coconut yield in the Union Territory. Therefore, as a natural resort, rather than chemical use for control of these rats, the administration of Lakshadweep has decided to use barn owls from the state of Kerala as a biocontrol measure, since we know that barn owls are a natural rat hunters. Biocontrol or biological control is a component of integrated pest management strategy. It aims at reduction of pest population by natural predator or enemies. In our case, It is reducing the rat population by barn owls. Here, rat is the pest and barn owl is the natural predator. The reason for not using cats or rat snakes is that in Lakshadweep Island, rats practically live in treetops and we are talking about coconuts. Therefore, barn owls are now to be used for pest control in order to control these rats. Now, let us know some few details about barn owls. The scientific name of the barn owls is Tyto alba, which belongs to the family Tytonidae. Barn owls are protected under Schedule 4 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Therefore, it cannot be hunted. But in situations such as when the animal or bird becomes dangerous to human life or to property, the chief wildlife warden or the authorized officer may permit any person to hunt the animal under Section 11 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. The property here includes standing crops also. Also, when an animal is disabled or deceased beyond recovery, then the chief wildlife warden or the authorized officer may permit any person to hunt the particular animal. A person may also kill that particular animal or a bird in order to exercise the right to self-defense also. Note that under Section 61 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, only the central government can add or delete an entry in the schedules, and the central government can transfer an entry among the schedules also. Barn owls are also protected under control trait under Appendix 2 of the CITES agreement as well. Appendix 2 of CITES agreement includes species that are not necessarily threatened with extinction, but in which trade must be controlled to avoid utilization that makes it incompatible or unsustainable for their survival. Know that Appendix 1 of CITES includes species threatened with extinction. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of this news article. Now, have a look at the practice prelims question. We shall discuss at the end of the analysis session. Now, let us move on to the analysis of the next news article. The sixth and the final news article of the day is India to add 3 million tech jobs by the year 2023. It is about the employment projections in technology sector by Indian Staffing Federation. This article will be helpful in your prelims preparation under Economic and Social Development and also in mains in General Studies Paper 3 under Indian Economy and Issues Relating to Employment, where you can use the statistics discussed in this news article for your mains answers. First, let us know in brief about Indian Staffing Federation, in short ISF. Indian Staffing Federation is a platform that provides for recognized employment and associated benefits such as work choice, compensation, annual benefits and health benefits. According to ISF, India has 40 crore employable workforce, out of which 4 crore workforce are in organized sector, that is 10%, and 25 crore workforce are self-employed, which amounts to 62.5%, and the remaining 27.5% are working in temporary staffing and unorganized sector. This ISF platform provides a sense of formalization and due recognition to the flexible workers or the temporary workers by outsourcing temporary workers to the required companies. The news article states that there were fears among millions of young technology and software engineering students that companies will push for automation, jobless growth, and replacing human resources with robots. But recently, tech employment projection given by Indian Staffing Federation states that India will add 30 lakh jobs in technology-driven areas by the year 2023. These new jobs would come up in digital technology areas such as artificial intelligence, machine learning, Internet of Things, data science, analytics, big data, and in augmented reality or in yet-to-emerge areas as well. Thus, India will be having around 70 lakh jobs in technology-driven areas by the year 2023. The article also notes that India is having an employed poverty problem, which means people are employed but under poverty. And this is mainly due to people working in unorganized sector as temporary workers because of non-formalization of jobs. The only sustainable solution for this problem, according to the president of ISF, is the formalization, industrialization, urbanization, and financialization of human capital or human resources in India. Formalization of human capital will result in giving labor rights and associated benefits. Next, industrialization of human capital will help in skill development. And urbanization of human capital is to make available and accessible the needed resources for companies. And finally, financialization is to remunerate the workforce. This remuneration shall be commensurable to the levels in order to bring the people in temporary workforce out of poverty. With this, we come to the end of the analysis of all the news articles taken up for today's discussion. Now, let us move on to the practice question discussion session. First question, consider the following statements with reference to the Bharatmala Pariyojana program. Statement 1, it aims at accelerating economic development in the country by harnessing the potential of India's coastline and river network. Statement 2, the components of the program include border and international connectivity roads, coastal and port connectivity roads, and expressways also. The question has asked for the correct answer. Here the first statement is wrong, as Bharatmala Pariyojana is an umbrella program in highway sector and it aims to optimize the efficiency of road traffic movement by building critical infrastructure gaps to make the movement of the man and material more efficient. But here the statement mentions about accelerating economic development in the country by harnessing the potential of India's coastline and river network, which is the vision of Sagarmala program, not Bharatmala program. The second statement here is correct, as we know from our discussion that the components of this Bharatmala Pariyojana are national corridors efficiency improvements, economic corridors development, inter-corridor, feeder roads, border roads, international connectivity roads, coastal and port connectivity roads, and expressways. The question here has asked for the correct answer. The correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only, since the first statement is wrong. Moving on to the second question, Association for Democratic Reforms, often seen in the news, refers to. Here it is a direct question. So here the correct answer is option C, which is a non-governmental organization working for promoting the democratic principles. Here, Transparency International works to achieve the vision of a world where government, business, civil society, and the daily lives of people are free of corruption. Moving on to the third question, consider the following statements. Statement 1, the collegium system is mentioned in the Indian Constitution. Statement 2, the selection panel for a Supreme Court judge consists of 5 senior most judges of the Supreme Court, including the Chief Justice of India. And the statement 3 is, the selection panel for a High Court judge consists of 3 senior most judges of the Supreme Court, including the Chief Justice of India. And here the question is asked for the correct options. Here the first statement is wrong. The collegium system is nowhere mentioned in the Indian Constitution. This collegium system was introduced by the Supreme Court. And here the second and third statements are direct statements which are correct. The question is asked for the correct answer. So the correct answer is option D, 2 and 3 only. Moving on to the fourth prelims question, consider the following statements with reference to the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Statement 1 is, a chief wildlife warden may allow a person to hunt an animal listed in Schedule 4 for the damage caused to the standing crops by the animal. And statement 2 is, while the state governments can add or delete an entry from any schedules, the central government can transfer an entry among the schedules under the Act. The first statement is correct, as Section 11 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972 allows a chief wildlife warden or an authorized officer who may allow a person to hunt an animal listed in Schedule 4 for damage caused to the standing crops by the animal or for damage to human life by that particular animal. The second statement here is wrong, because under Section 61 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972, the power to alter entries in schedules rests with the central government and not with the state government. Hence, the correct answer for this question will be option A, 1 only, because the question is asked to choose the correct options. Moving on to the practice mains question. The question is, examine the trade issues between the oldest and largest democracies in the world. Suggest ways and means to tide over the trade tensions. Here, USA is the oldest democracy and India is the largest democracy in the world. The first part of the question is asked to examine the ongoing trade issues between India and USA. We have discussed in detail about this in our editorial analysis. You can mention some issues like significant reductions exemption, in short called as SRE, generalized system of preference status, in short GSP status, tariff hikes by both nations, e-commerce policy of India, and the likes. The second part is asked for suggestions to overcome these trade tensions. You can include the contents discussed in our editorial analysis. And also, you can also add your own suggestions as well. With this, we come to the end of the practice question discussion session. Please do like, comment, and share the video. And please subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for latest videos and updates. Stay focused and motivated, friends. Thank you.